Welcome, listeners, to a new episode for the networked world here on Radio Korax, the free radio around a local area in Germany and also on the internet. We are welcoming you. We are connected remotely by the internet. We are sitting in our own rooms and want to have a show. And Lisa is our guest today. Hello, Lisa.
Hello, Lisa.
Hello.
Hallo, guten Abend.
Hallo. Wir sind
also there are Nilo and Markus and Tim and Joti.
Hallo.
And today, maybe you already noticed in my voice, we are talking about something that I find a heavy topic. It's about fake news. Everything is fake.
Lisa
is doing research in that area. And yeah, we want to talk about that, and of course the reason is the COVID-19 pandemic. Yeah, well, there was an incident in Berlin, the Corona demonstration. They were demonstrating or protesting the Corona.
Ich sage es in Anführungsstrichen.
Not the pandemic itself, but the countermeasures. And people were trying to enter the Reichstag. And yeah, we want to talk about this whole topic. So, Lisa, maybe you can tell us what made you look into this? What exactly are you checking out? Well, maybe at the beginning I should clarify that I'm not doing research. I am working in media pedagogy. Sorry, I have trouble with that word. So I am looking into reactions on the network and try to develop competences about doing research and how to distinguish fakes and conspiracies and fake news. And I have been working with that for a long time. I have workshops with kids and teenagers. But yeah, most, especially in the last few months, you already mentioned with the Corona pandemic, increasingly more. So we are noticing it more and the public is noticing it more. That the internet is overflooded with, well, yeah, just fake news and just people claiming things. And that is my incentive. So yeah, people claiming things that are wrong, just like it happened to me, that I am saying you are doing research. That's part of your everyday work, but that's what we want to talk about today as well. So we want to talk about claims that are done knowingly, or would you put it differently? So maybe let me put it this way. There is the claim that this COVID virus or this coronavirus, there's the claim that it is a weapon created by the Chinese to attack all of us. So where does the claim come from? Why do people believe that? I think that first we have to differentiate. What are we even talking about? And yeah, you already said that there are fakes and fake news. And those are claims that are made knowingly. Those are fakes that don't happen by accident, but people know what they are saying. They try to manipulate something. It's not people telling something when they don't know any better. And of course, we have to learn how to handle that as well. We have to be critical with things we are reading online. But that also happens in every talk we have in everyday life, whenever we are talking to someone, that can happen. But here we have a political dimension. So this is used as an instrument to manipulate people's opinions. And when we then go a step further with the example you mentioned, with the virus
Virus, das dann von der Regierung
X some government oder so used it and created it
in die Welt geschmissen wurde, das sind dann
those are actually conspiracy theories.
Also,
oh, I'm not saying theories, it's because a theory would have some kind of evidence or scientific claim.
But
here, usually, we don't actually have that, so it's better to talk about conspiracy myths. And of course, that's a political instrument as well. To also use your own ideology or strengthen your own ideology and bring it into the public and convince people if possible, especially in this context, because you were asking, why do people even believe that?
Ja, auch das ist so ein Ding, das natürlich.
Yeah, that's also something, especially in a pandemic, it's a crisis.
Also ist eine Gesellschaft.
It's a health crisis and a public crisis.
Und
and es gibt a lot of people Menschen, don't know how to handle a crisis.
Also die,
they are really insecure
in Bezug auf
about their own lives. How will I go on? Will I get sick myself?
Oder nicht?
Will I lose my job?
Job?
Also so they are losing control.
Im Prinzip für, ja,
basically for all people, but some people can handle it better and others can't handle it as well. And some can compensate for it and others can't. And such a conspiracy myth, that can be a crutch. Because
weil so eine Verschwörungserzählung mir letzten Endes nur
such a myth, it gives you, it provides a simple answer.
Die ich stand. Kann, die ja im besten
and Fall ideally it fits my world
passt,
image.
Und das ist viel einfacher dann auszuhalten in dem Moment,
and that's als mit diesen easier to stand so, than so all these insecurities.
Kein Mensch weiß, wie lange dauert es oder nicht. Genau, also das.
Also würde man sagen,
so could it be said that the more crises there are, because I'm seeing a lot of crises that came since, let's say, at least the last 20 years. I mean, there was terror, there was war, and now, even starting more than 10 years ago, the finance crisis, could we say that the insecurity grows due to this?
Die sozusagen
and the people get more willing to believe other explanations other than facts provided by scientists, for example. Yes, and there has been research for that, or into that, that people more readily believe those conspiracy narratives the more the crises happen. So that can be public crises like the pandemic, but it could also be a personal crisis like losing your partner. So whatever makes you feel like you lose control, and adding the internet to all this and how the internet works with the social networks, the also filter we see that can also increase this, yeah, they can lead to filter bubbles where you only get news that go into a certain direction and that reinforces these narratives. And yeah, just looking at the last 10-20 years, that has increased definitely. But does it maybe only happen to me if I, or does it happen to me more if I am only in such groups and don't listen to real news anymore? Because just personally, subjectively, I can't imagine that. Because you said that it's that you are looking for more easy solutions rather than the complex reality. When I look into this, I don't really think the solutions they are offering are simple. It's not a simple thing to say the Earth is flat or Bill Gates wants to control us. So Bill Gates created a virus so he can vaccinate us. That's a complex story and difficult to follow. So how does that work? Do you think if you mix your media well, that doesn't happen?
gefragt, so.
Ja,
well, also zu der one thing einen Sache, to warum, also the Bill Gates conspiracy, for example, so that's mostly because
vor allem auch dann
you have a person, halt you have a Person, face.
Man hat ein Gesicht dazu, man hat irgendwie
you have ja, a projection area where you can project your fears. A virus is invisible.
Genau, aber der Punkt
and mixing the news and the media, yeah, of course, that plays a role.
Klar,
if you only are in social networks
und da jetzt,
and, for example, Facebook, it's a very
Netzwerk in den Kreisen oder auch jetzt inzwischen
they like it in those circles.
In
or, for example, messengers like Telegram now, that's a completely closed group. And people in those groups, all day, every day, they feed each other with reinforcing information. And yeah, if I diversify my information, that gets thinned. So
it's
not reinforcing itself. But people don't want that. They want their own worldview reinforced. So if they are looking for easy solutions, yeah, that's at least one reasoning. Of course, there are different reasons. At least there is the question, is it a new phenomenon? Or because, you know, fake news existed before now. Did this get created by filter bubbles and the technology, or was this a thing early in history? Yeah, there was something, actually. So, the name fake news itself, it was first used publicly 1890 in the American or in the English language American lexicon Webster's dictionary.
Webster's dictionary war das.
And that was the first documented use.
Auch ich würde sagen, dass
yeah, since then, I would say since there are news and public communication, there's also the phenomenon of fake news.
Der Falschmeldungen, also
of course, to varying degrees. Sometimes fake news are just accidents. But sometimes that was on purpose. Let's just think about propaganda. During the Nazi time, for example, there was a lot of fake news. If you want to call it that. So it's not a new phenomenon. But what is changing because of the options of the possibilities due to social networks is that every single one of us has the possibility to publish publicly. So you don't need to be a journalist anymore, or you don't need to have some feeling of responsibility. You can just put out your opinions into the net. And what we could not do yet is that at the same time as the options, the possibilities grow, we also have the responsibilities grow. So we should think about what is happening with all the information that I put out there, or the news I put out there. Everyone can see that. So it did change a little, but the phenomenon itself is not a new thing.
Aber ich meine, der Umfang.
Yeah, but the amount. Well, it feels like the amount increased a lot this year. But I can't really tell. I saw the pictures from the thing in Berlin, from the incident. There were a few things where you would think, well, it's not just 5 to 6 crazy people that you see in the marketplace every week. But it is quite a lot of people, and I can't really tell how is it? Is it more? Because not all of them did go to Berlin. If this many people did go,
Also mit viele meine ich
Well,
jetzt nicht diese
it won't be a few
Millionen,
million,
die von
like
ihnen
they like
selbst
to
immer
claim.
veröffentlicht werden.
I don't know how many it were.
Ich weiß
There
nicht, wie
were
viele es waren.
maybe 20,000, I don't know.
20.000, keine Ahnung.
Ich glaube,
I think even 38,000 at the last demo.
Ja.
So yeah,
ja, auf jeden
it's
Fall.
Crazy. It's disturbing how many people there are.
Es geht quer durch
it's
die Gesellschaft und meine persönliche
all over the society. And I mean, 10 years ago, I was laughing.
Also
who could believe something like that? But now,
und mittlerweile
I'm scared.
Ein bisschen Schiss bekomme. Also, das ist
so, no, it's not funny what's happening there.
Und also,
and that's not something I want to say. It's something from Katharina Nuku by a video that will be in the show notes. People prefer believing, and that's what I don't understand. Crazy stories, I want to call it. For example, I mean, reality is that this virus mutated and it changed in a way that it can now jump from the animal to humans. And probably humans are responsible for that in some way because of the markets, what's happening with the animals there, but it did happen. And I think it's easier to accept that as reality than to think that all of this was planned for a long time. And yeah, just choose an enemy, Bill Gates, Jews, or someone to get world domination. Yeah, and I also think you have to recognize that the people who distribute those fake news, that's not just some random person. Of course, everyday people also tell crazy things like onions can heal everything or can heal Corona. But a lot of these people, they do it semi-professionally with a political agenda. And those people, it has to be said, it is mostly right-wing, and they try to justify their own worldview using now this way to attack the existing system, the existing political system, our free and democratic system. They want to at least weaken it with this very emotional topic. And they tried that before. They had different topics before, but now they use this topic. And yeah, at the same time, I also think that, yeah, 38,000 people in Berlin, that's so many people, way too many. But there were also other interviews that showed that at least 80% of the public are also wanting to fight Corona using these measures that were taken. So it shouldn't influence us too much because, of course, the media is looking at this very closely and we see it in the news every day, all day, and in the end you have a feeling like, yeah, hold on, Germany is full of Nazis.
Ja, aber es fällt mir gerade wirklich schwer. Also siehe Hallischer Marktplatz, auch schon vor Covid, diese Veranstaltung da.
Yeah, it's difficult for me. I mean, see at the marketplace in Halle and also 1 year ago this terror attack in Halle, where there was a person who is a politician and in Kassel, and he was murdered by an extremist. And I'm scared about that. I want to go freely around in my surroundings outside without having fear of people accusing me. And this is attacking the stability of our of our living together, of our society. Yes, I mean, there are diverse leaks from conversation strategies, for example, from the Identitären, an extremist group in Germany. And yeah, what we see there is how they, I don't know how to say it in the correct way, but how they communicate in the net. They call it an information war. And this is actually a disinformation campaign, which from above is enforced. And yeah, those are people who also in real life are ready to take violent, to be violent. And they are also radicalized in the net and radicalizing others. And those fakes are very fast at topics like hate speech in the internet, and this is going to be a lot, the fake news have to be a lot worse, a lot harsher, so that it's still going on. Because if this doesn't happen, the people don't follow them anymore, and this is how the radicalization is already part of this. So what can we do? Can we do anything? We can try to talk about it, to educate about it, to put it in context. Yes, of course. I think it is very important to have it on the radar, that it happens, that it exists. And I hear from many people, especially in the last years, I did a lot of talks to this topic, a lot of workshops, and many people were really sad because they didn't know anymore what to do with their family members or their friends who never had anything to do with the extreme right, but now are into the topic through those conspiracies. And the people are searching for ways and solutions to talk with those people, with those friends and family members. It's really difficult. I don't know if you had the problem before, or yeah, if you know someone who comes with an argumentation like that, you really have trouble getting to that person. This isn't what this person wants to discuss facts. It's more like a psychological thing that, yeah, you have to be like more therapy. You have to make it therapy, and you can't claim this from people who aren't educated in it. And you can't just come from the outside if you see someone. I met someone in a staircase, a person whom I know from a long time ago, and I didn't have much of a motivation to discuss with him. But yeah, if it's like in your personal inner circle with friends or people, very difficult. I think it's hard because you can't start with real arguments because they say you're the Schlafschaf, the sleeping sheep, or they don't believe you, and no argument is working. Yeah, exactly. It's not about having the best argument or scientific data. But Katharina Nodun is writing about that in her new book. And it's about it's about relations. Maybe you should ask, how are you actually?
Yeah,
I can relate with that. With my grandparents and their generation, they are very skeptical against migration and people from other countries. And if something goes wrong, they always say it's the people who came here from abroad. And you can't argue with them. but so you have to sit down very calm and tell them, well, it actually isn't like that. And if you look around, we aren't actually really affected by that. But you can't think that they people give in eventually. But sometimes maybe they think about it in the aftermath. Yeah, you have to differentiate when they got in this. Does this belong into their whole worldview? Especially the people who just drifted away in the last month, there you should really try it. Before they get into this deeper. What I ask myself, those people don't realize themselves they drifted away, but how do you realize it yourselves that you are in such a filter bubble, that you believe such a theory? Yeah, that's a very good point, because, of course, also we, maybe, probably everyone has their theories and their bubbles who are maybe a little more transparent than others, but the difference, or, yeah, you have to reflect yourself. If you realize that you yourself in discussions talk, don't argue with facts, but with just one answer and always tell that there's just one answer, then that can be a hint that maybe you are a little too focused if you only have like one answer. And I think that in my filter bubble and also in the networks, but generally also with the people who are in my surroundings, there you already realize in the communication and how people say things that you are still open for other views. But I don't know, maybe also this is just something I use as an excuse. What I can imagine is that especially because of the pandemic, the science and everything that is evidence-based should be shared with the public so that people can relate to it, see it in, and that the communication with the science have to be so good that fact-based things can be transported into the public. There are very nice introductions into that, that are backed by studies and presented in a nice way. Maybe you can use this as an introduction. This is right, but this only gets a very small part of the population, because you need to have some knowledge to understand it. And there are big parts of the population who you need to pick up at a very different point. For example, people who, very placatively speaking, like you are a mother of three children, no father, and you have to think about nurturing the children, and you don't have time to get into such stuff. But there is some point where you have to get off steam, and then I might be more prone to those easy answers. I mean, this is very placative. It don't have to be like that in all cases, but I think this is a very important point. And school, I mean, much of that now is helping me to identify fake news and to identify, for example, how Trump is agitating. Much of this knowledge I know from school, from history lessons, but also from science. What can I trust in? What can I use already as a young person? And now this helps me to differentiate things. Topic school is very interesting. For example, in a German newspaper, there was an article about this, about the competence of teachers. And I will pack the link in that you can see it. It's about how teachers trust in the usual media, and also in this group there's a lot of skeptics against the media. So they don't trust the established channels. And if you have the situation that even the teachers in the school don't believe in this, then who is showing it to the children? Maybe the YouTubers who have a lot of followers, and maybe they are like a big brother or sister who can educate the children. But then, of course, in your YouTube account, also the filter bubble has to be the right one.
Oder die TikTok oder was
auch immer,
die nicht einfach die heile Welt.
You don't have those who like do TikTok and want to play like nice world, but to educate them. And I mean, it's actually really funny because this YouTube thing, it's all from a capitalist standpoint that it emerged. But yeah, you say it is very difficult to get to this target group, and I wish that this is a lot easier, like earlier, like in the lessons with the teachers. Tell me something in like 20 minutes and not with all those scientific facts and stuff, and I just want an explanation, like simple. That you explain it to me.
Aufmerksamkeitsspanne ist nicht 20 Minuten.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like you only can be there for 20 minutes with your head.
Auch wenn das sehr interessant ist.
Very interesting.
Ist halt dann schwierig. Und dann möchtest du lieber bespaßt werden. Und
yeah, when you think about kids, they have school already all day. They have those lessons, that scientific stuff that you want to have, and maybe they want the change. They want something more entertainment for a change.
Es gab irgendwann auch so einen Trend in Dokumentation, dass auf eine Stunde.
Now there was once upon a time there was this trend to have documentations or docus.
Weiß ich nicht, wenn ich jetzt schon Zeit aufbringe, mir irgendwas reinzuziehen, will ich auch
ein
paar wissen und nicht nur so wenig.
Try to make those
gut, aber das ist natürlich
to an hour and just have four facts, but I want more.
Aufmerksamkeitsspanne. Wir sind jetzt ungefähr so eine halbe Stunde drin.
Yeah, so we are already talking. Who is still listening? Who is radio?
Kann man mit
we
Musik
could wake people up with music.
Wir haben was im Kasten.
Das war unser Mal mit Wenn ihr wüsstet.
Oh.
Und genauso brandheiß
Music Intro
präsentiert wird, geht es jetzt hier weiter. Wir sind heute bei Sendung für die vernetzte Welt, Folge 96.
Right now there is a fake short interim. Verschwörung. That explains to the radio listeners what was happening.
Auch wirklich immer mal so,
yeah, when I think of fake news, I think Twitter.
Dass es häufiger vorkommt,
and I noticed that Twitter posts nowadays are marked sometimes.
Oder anderen prominenten
even by,
die doch dann quasi immer wieder
yeah, even by people who were
nicht ganz so passend
told several times that it might not be correct.
So ein bisschen,
do you think that is a good way that should be used more in the future
wird, dann
to
Dinge,
mark obviously wrong things?
Markiert oder gekennzeichnet werden?
Well,
that has been a bit debate for a long time. Who is responsible for
zum Beispiel,
for hate speech, but also for fake news?
Fake news aus dem
to remove that from the net? Or how we should handle that? And politicians often say, well, the networks, they are responsible, they should do it. But the networks say, well, so far they said no. We are only having a platform, and whatever the users do, that's not our responsibility. Well, in the past, the networks also were slow to react. Then there came this new law in Germany that was supposed to force the networks to remove hate speech, for example. Surprisingly, now, with all these fake news around Corona, we could see that the networks were reacting quite quickly. In a very short amount of time, they were changing their community standards and changing their algorithms. So, at least at YouTube, on YouTube, fake news were deleted more quickly. And also the algorithms, they were working differently from before, so you were not getting 10 more fake news right after this conspiracy. And also Twitter now has this mark. And not only that, now they also have this banner or this location where it says, yeah, here you can get scientific information and a link. So YouTube is now linking to the official website where you can find scientific information, and I like that they are reacting more quickly, but I also have a bit of a stomach ache because I'm not certain I want to trust the technology there, because it's never as reliable as we would like it to be. So it's not exactly filtering what we would like filtered, but what about satire? So the German version of The Onion, Postillon, that's not fake news, it's satire. And it's very difficult to decide what is fake news, who has the authority to write on the internet. And that is a whole different can of worms, basically. Because I don't want profit-oriented companies to decide on those. So yeah, filtering as well, but more competence at the people, that's mostly it. And yeah, more netiquette. I heard an old thing on YouTube, and one of the comments was, hi, I am old, and I listened to this a long time ago, and I still like it. And a lot of other people said, yeah, I'm also older than 60, older than 70, and they were very polite, and someone said, you old people are so cute. And I'm sitting there and thinking, you old people? You're not cute. You are not cute, you're civilized. You're talking about a topic, and that's what the platform is there. And in this case, it was a song, of course. They were talking nicely. And they weren't saying, the other one was better, and no, you are wrong. And YouTube comments are sometimes, like, terrible. I'm not saying that's that way everywhere, but you have to choose your community well. And I myself think I closed that. I don't need that. But as a teenager, I can see the pressure to also be into the more cool or established communities. As a grown-up, I can see, well, it's a toxic community. I'm not reading that anymore. I'm not needing that. I have enough hate without having hate in my free time as well. But yeah, I know that I'm building a bubble myself. Just a bubble without hate. Yeah, but I also think that's a nice wish, because I also would like that. And we were talking about responsibility before. So
Leute einfach an der Stelle
people don't understand what are the options, what are the possibilities and what are the responsibilities of talking freely and being careful about what they write online and how they might hurt other people with what they're writing. And that's something that has to be learned. And I have a feeling that some people have no impulse control. I notice it in myself. Sometimes you're reading a tweet and think, wow, that's so stupid, and you would like to start a flame war, basically. But I usually try to keep myself back and lay it away and think about it, maybe write something qualified, but not in this emotional process. But that's what happens. It's like a high where you are putting out exclamation marks. Yeah. You also never know how old the people are. I could imagine that maybe they have less experience. Some of these people might have less impulse control, and that would also, yeah, that would also be my question. What part of the problem are kids and teenagers? Because that's not what you see in the public discourse, how old someone is.
Yeah,
well, that varies widely. You cannot just generally say kids and teenagers, because it's also a question of groups and, well, communities. Just as they are talking to each other differently in the schoolyard, it's also online. And I would say, in part, they sometimes know better what they are doing and what is uncool online, more so than some adults.
But
yeah, it's a very personal thing. But yeah, teenagers, at least in school, they get the option to talk about these things, depending on their teachers, of course. There might even be workshops to these topics, about these topics. But some adults, it's really difficult. Don't you think that with kids in school that there is a very different socializing? When I think back that we had a chat for our classroom, and if someone was misbehaving, then this group could also self-regulate. Especially if there was just one sticking out. Yeah, definitely, that is happening. And I would say in many classrooms, I would say pretty much every classroom has a WhatsApp group now. But in most classes that I see, there are rules for the chat room. So the students together, they talked about it together with the teacher, and they talked about cybermobbing, and that's something that's definitely happening. But they are creating rules for themselves. How strictly they stick to the rules, that's another topic, as always, and how well the teacher can observe that. But yeah, there are many groups where it's quite well self-regulating, but also there are other groups, of course, where there is terrible cybermobbing. That definitely exists. Well, if nobody controls it, and the parents usually don't know these chats, maybe that's changing now, but especially if you have a pandemic and it's about homework and control, that is an important topic. I don't know, but I can definitely imagine that if nobody is checking that and nobody is self-regulating, nobody is saying that's too much, that's not cool, then it's probably increasing. It's getting worse. But yeah, that always existed. Mobbing in school classes, that was always a problem. And when I remember back, I don't know a single teacher who went in there and said, guys, that you don't do that. We don't do that. You shouldn't. That was always self-regulated. And for many, it was not self-regulating in a positive way. And now we have the same thing in a digital way. And sometimes it's even worse because it's around the clock. In the analog world, you are limited to personally being there, and it's only during school time. But now it's around the clock, and it's black and white.
Yeah,
I mean, it's also a thing of proper behavior. And usually, yeah, that is the job of the parents to educate the children. And if I remember back at my childhood, when I was misbehaving, my parents were saying, yeah, think about how they feel. Would you like being excluded like that? And that worked on me. And when you are a teenager, that starts anyways. Yeah, definitely. Empathy is a key word. And we are back at hate speech in the net on etiquette. How we call it in German. Would I like being talked to like that? And that's how I should talk to others as well. For example, in YouTube, there's a fraction of the comments, very few, where people change their opinion, where they say, yeah, I said something and I did some research and I was wrong. Mm-hmm. And that's something a person, a social being, should be able to do. Because it can be, it's always possible that you misread, you mix something up, and then you write something, and you are certain. And later you figure out you were wrong. But that is something everyone should be able to do. And I would say, if more people were able to do that and willing to do that, we would have a nicer community.
Yeah.
Ja, yeah, I think Nilo wanted to say something.
Ja, ja, genau. Ich wollte noch,
dass es auch
festgehalten ist, was halt
mentioned, auch what's not helpful as well, I think we weren't really talking about that,
ist,
is this
an oder
laughing about people and enjoying people from these
Demonstrationen, wo
protests
where geht und die Leute
the press is going and interviewing
und die,
and
diese abstrusesten
Verschwörungsgeschichten
da
listening to the most
teilweise
strange narratives.
Das ist, finde ich, halt
obviously drunk sometimes, and I think that hurts,
und ich finde, das
and
muss sein,
it's not necessary to watch to that.
I mean, uns betrunken ansprechen, ne? Das ist Wahnsinn.
Yeah.
Ja, aber
but media is also responding to the people who want to consume that kind of thing, and it has to increase. It has to be faster, worse. And there is this very terrible tabloid in Germany. It's always getting worse. And it has to increase ever further. And some private TV stations, they do the same thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, you have to think about if a state, as politicians, you want to sanction such things. If we think as society, like we boycott these newspapers or these formats where you already feel that this is trying to insecure you, and yeah, the market should the market doesn't regulate it. There has to come someone and say we don't do this.
Ganz gut überhaupt, dass es keinen Staatsrundfunk gibt in dem Sinne.
Yeah, I mean, we already had the topic that we don't want that there is no state funk, where we have this like public broadcasting, and there is also a program that is responsible for critiquing, but there's the Presserat, and yeah, there is this newspaper, the German, and they critique it very much, but it doesn't show any. Yeah, they ignore it, and
an der Stelle sehe ich.
In this place, I think it's more about media competence.
schwierig ist, das zu sagen, das Subjekt.
It's difficult to just say the subject is the one responsible always, which has to see through everything. It's difficult. I mean, if you see that some media or press companies, like companies which think in an economic way and to have to sell, which even increases with the internet because there's even more concurrence and you need those incomes, and this makes that it's always like higher, faster, further. And there were a lot of moments when also renominated newspapers wrote rubbish just because they wanted to be the first ones, and this makes people mistrust the news, the media, and you have to think about this. The redactional media, there are journalists who learn that, and sometimes they make mistakes and they do such things. And if you look in the history, you see a lot of press, which is just rubbish, just fake. I mean, I don't want to be censored. I don't want any censorship, but we live in a world where pictures and symbols are important, even more important than facts, and maybe you have to do something against that, and maybe the first pages, which, I mean, this has to hurt those media who do the fake news, it has to hurt them. But I mean, I'm ready to discuss about this. I think we do too less. We let them do too much, and it's the luxury of living in this society that we can let them do that. And the open society also has to take limits, to say there is our limit, we don't go beyond that, and we maybe not laws, but maybe there should be like actions of you have to apologize like in the first 10 sites of your pages of your newspaper instead of putting advertisements there. Yeah, I mean, a strong democracy has to suffer a lot, has to cope a lot of things, and there have to be limits. Like we're standing with one leg on the law, and there are a lot of laws that tell how those things have to work, but maybe we just have to use our laws and our tools more effectively, or maybe should we just educate more also teenagers and children in media competence, maybe especially those kids and teenagers are those whom we still can help, who haven't drifted away so far yet. And maybe if they know it better, then they tell, and maybe this is how we can go a step further, how we can progress. With children you can still talk in discussions. You still can reach them, but sometimes I ask myself how good you actually get to them. But in the end, you need to educate not only children, but all people. I mean, you have those colleges, but also you, maybe the employers should be responsible and also educate their people. Because, also those people have a responsibility. With the digital transformation of society, this is new land for many people, and you have to
ganz schönes Schlusspunkt. Wir sind jetzt knapp an einer Stunde.
See how you work with it. Maybe this is a nice plateau here for the end. I would like to summarize, which means we want more media competence.
Ja, man sollte natürlich.
And in the end, it's right. You should question things that are said somewhere that are distributed in the end, but you shouldn't believe the most simple truth. That's what I would like to summarize. Nice. I would like more polite comments on YouTube and more respect in the internet. Maybe then people really want to write and want to talk about things. And yeah, maybe if the next time someone writes bad words in capital letters, then maybe you have to think it's like
irgendwie immer noch so aktuell ist, ne? Dass es irgendwie eine Art Hilferuf ist.
A shout for love, like a shout for help, and maybe this is about you should show the.
Super, und ich denke, wir sollten den Titel jetzt einfach nochmal anspielen.
How difficult it is for that.
Und die Sendung hier mit.
Maybe you should check the title.